Today we want to look at the question, how do I obtain forgiveness? What is the basic requirement to get forgiveness for my sins? The question is, what is forgiveness anyway? Why do I need forgiveness? The scripture tells us that God is holy, that His commandments are holy, that His commandments represent His character, His nature, and that man, by choosing to sin, has separated himself from God. God is life. Any man who separates himself from life becomes lifeless, even if he still exists for a certain time. The purpose of life that God actually intended for man can no longer be achieved. And yet God wants this to change. He wants man to live forever. If sin separates man from God, then man needs something to remove this separation from God. The Holy Scripture calls this forgiveness. The question is, what do I need? How do I receive forgiveness? God has given man free will. God will never, not even once, impose heaven on man. God will not force anything good on man. Forgiveness is something that God is happy to provide to man. Jesus Christ Himself paid the price for our forgiveness. The only question is whether I want His forgiveness. How can I find out if I really want forgiveness? Maybe I express this with my words, maybe with certain actions. I try to change, try to become a better person. Maybe I try to give money, to donate, to support good projects. Maybe I try to show that I might not be able to earn heaven directly, but I can qualify a little better for it. These are all deceptive intentions. A person will never become good in God's eyes by his own effort, by his own endeavor. God makes everything good. Just as He made the forest and all the things that He created, just as He spoke and the trees came into being, God speaks forgiveness and cleansing into man. But the prerequisite is that man wants this. It is not what he says, not what he does outwardly. It is not what he tries to present in front of other people. It is what he really wants, what he really desires. That is, if he really wants forgiveness from God, he will receive it. Now, the scripture tells us that our hearts and our thoughts are deceitful. That is, we can deceive ourselves in our own thoughts. How do we know that we really want forgiveness and cleansing? The scripture reveals this to us. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. This verse says, repent and be converted. In other words, conversion and sincere repentance is revealed in a person turning back from his ways. He stops doing the wrong things that he used to do. He allows the power of God to create in him something new. However, as it always happens, there can be misunderstandings. Some people think that they have to change their behavior by their own efforts in order to show real conversion. But this is not true. There are people who repent outwardly from their deeds because they fear the consequences. But according to the Bible, this is not true conversion. Pharaoh had experienced different plagues, and he was willing to be obedient, only that the judgments of God would not fall on him. But as soon as God removed the plagues, he became reluctant again. This was not a true conversion. True conversion is a change of heart. There is a big difference between lamenting the consequences of my sins and lamenting sin. If you think about it and understand what sin has actually done, what suffering it has brought into this world, you can see how terrible sin is in God's eyes. So many times sin is seen as something technical. I parked the wrong way. I got a ticket because I have been speeding. But sin is much more than just a small transgression. The law of God represents the character of God. It represents His nature. When a person transgresses the law of God, the Bible calls this sin. God suffers on an emotional level because of our sins. It hurts Him. It hurts Him when we go against His character. Why? Well, one explanation is that when a person sins and goes against the will of God, when he consciously makes a decision to do something that he knows God does not want him to do, it reveals a distrust in the love and character of God. Man thinks that God is withholding something good from him. I could have something here, but he does not want me to be happy. He does not want to give me this and that. Man does not believe God. He does not trust Him. True conversion and true repentance are revealed in the fact that man starts to believe and trust again. He understands that God means well with him. He does not doubt His love. And a person who experiences this conversion, this repentance, will practice in his life something that we call obedience. Jesus says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." In fact, it is not possible to keep God's commandments if we do not love Him with all our hearts. How could love be awakened in our hearts? By looking at what He has done for us because of our sins. By looking at how He looks at sin, how He evaluates it, and yet how mercifully He deals with us. God is a just God. He will never sweep any sin under the rug. He is just, perfectly just, but He gives perfect freedom. Man may decide whether he wants to live or die. And at the same time, God is also perfect love. He gave Himself for us. And when we look at the consequences of sin, we see how terrible sin really is. If I want to experience true conversion, then it is necessary for me to understand what sin really is. Not only to consider it as a technical transgression, but to see that sin goes against the character of God, against His nature. It is necessary that we get a deeper understanding of what sin causes. To be exact, to understand how sin breaks the heart of God when we choose to disobey. When I realize how terrible sin is, I can better realize the love of God, that He was willing to give His Son for me. In Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, it is written, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile." David also says in Psalm 51, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me." A person cannot come up with such thoughts. It is God that moved David to speak these words. It is God who gives the enmity into our hearts against sin. Only by His Spirit, by the action of His Spirit, can we receive a longing for purity and holiness. For David, it was important that God not only forgives him, but gives him a pure heart, that He gives him a new mind. For David, it was important to come back into the holiness of God, to have communion with God. That was the most important thing for him. When we have this longing, when we have the genuine repentance from sin, when we experience genuine and sincere conversion, we will not only want the consequences to go away, the punishment to go away, but we'll have a longing for communion with God. A person cannot produce these thoughts. It is only through God's Spirit that we have these desires. What can I do if I personally realize that I do not have such repentance? Well, I can ask God for it. I can say, Lord, I have not had David's experience. I don't have hatred towards sin as you do. Can you create a new heart in me? Can you give me new thoughts? Help that my thoughts are focused on you, that I don't look at myself and focus on my own person, but on you and on what you can do. Help me not to look at myself and how good I am, but to pay attention to how holy you are. Help me not to compare myself with other people and their sins and think that I am not so bad, but help me to take you as my example, to compare my character with yours. This is a prayer that I can pray to God so that He can create something new in me. The beautiful thing is that we can come to God just as we are. We do not need to wait until we have found this holiness and repentance in ourselves. We are allowed to come to Him as we are. It is written, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus is ready to accept every person who comes to Him. And to every person who has a longing for true repentance and conversion, God will give him repentance. Do you want to have this experience? Do you long to know the purity and holiness of God? Do you want to be cleansed from your sins? I can tell you, you can come to God as you are. I would like to invite you, shall we ask God to give us this experience? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you have created this world. And we thank you so much that you can create a new heart in us. Father, I pray that you will help us to realize how sinful and ugly sin is. I pray that you will help us to see sin through your eyes. And I pray, Father, that you will put in our hearts a hatred towards sin. Give us new thoughts, give us new mind, give us a new heart. And help us, Father, to love you so much that we will have a hatred for sin like you do. Father, I thank you that you can work these things in us. And I thank you that I know you're going to listen our prayer because we prayed in Jesus' name. Amen.